This is Dr. Kathleen Kiernan, and I'll be presenting neutropenic fever. I'm a Duke University Medical Center second-year resident. The learning objectives for this presentation are as follows. Basically, you'll need to know the definition of neutropenic fever, know how to assess a patient who has this problem, and know what concepts you'll need to use in terms of therapy in this setting. The outline for this presentation includes the definition of both neutropenia and neutropenic fever, how to assess this particular patient, which laboratory studies and microbiologic data you should obtain, what concepts you should know surrounding therapy and the choice of antimicrobials, a case for review, and finally at the end a practice board question. The definition of neutropenic fever begins with the definition of neutropenia. This is defined as an absolute neutrophil count, or an ANC, of less than 500. I've included in front of you the calculation for how to do this, although in general you will not need to know this. Neutropenic fever is a single temperature of greater than or equal to 38.3 degrees Celsius, which is 101 degrees Fahrenheit, or a sustained temperature of 38.0 degrees Celsius for more than 1 hour in a patient with neutropenia. Just a little bit about neutrophils, their form and their function. They're called neutrophils because they stain a neutral pink on an H&E stain, unlike eosinophils, which stain a bright red, or basophils, which stain a deep blue. They're larger than red blood cells, as you can see, and they have a segmented nucleus with bridging chromatin, which are the strings you can see between the parts of the nucleus in front of you. The initial assessment of this patient would include an updated focus history, any new signs or symptoms that have developed, followed by a thorough physical exam, looking over the skin, a good pulmonary exam, a neurologic exam, and also asking any questions related to abdominal complaints while examining the abdomen. The laboratory studies would be a CBC with differential, a BUN and creatinine or a Chem7, as well as transaminases or a GI panel. Microbiologic data is some of the most important data you obtain, including blood and urine cultures, a chest x-ray, a Clostridium difficile toxin, especially if they're having symptoms such as more than 3 watery bowel movements in a day. The most important thing to see about this busy slide for treatment of a patient with neutropenic fever are that patients are divided into 2 main categories, low risk and high risk. Low risk patients are those with anticipated neutropenia for less than a week, who are clinically stable and generally are pretty healthy with no other major medical problems. High risk patients are those who are anticipated to be neutropenic for more than 7 days, who are clinically unstable, generally anyone who is an inpatient and anyone with medical comorbidities. The second most important thing to see about this slide is involving inpatient IV antibiotics. The choices you see in front of you are for broad coverage of gram-negative bacteria, which are the most common causes of clinical decompensation in these patients. This is a case example. A 60-year-old male with acute myelogenous leukemia is receiving inpatient induction chemotherapy. On his 5th night in the hospital, the nurse calls you and states that he has a fever to 38.3. His vital signs, including his blood pressure and heart rate, are stable, and he's not hypoxic. What do you do first? So the right first thing to do is to go assess the patient, ask focused questions about their symptoms, and do a complete physical exam. In general, it is still recommended to avoid a rectal exam in these patients to avoid more bleeding. You find that he is having normal stools and no new symptoms. Therefore, you order a CBC with a differential and a chemistry panel. You can hold off on a Clostridium difficile toxin, as he's not clinically having symptoms consistent with this infection. You also would order blood cultures, a urinalysis and urine culture, as well as a chest x-ray. Once these various labs are drawn, you would start empiric IV cefepime for broad gram-negative coverage and await your lab and micro results. This is a good practice board question developed from one that I saw during my studying. A 45-year-old female with acute myelogenous leukemia is undergoing chemotherapy. 1 week after induction, she develops confusion, a fever, and headache. On physical exam, she is altered with nuchal rigidity, photophobia, and a positive Koenig sign. Her labs are significant for an ANC of 170, so she's certainly neutropenic, a hemoglobin of 7.8, and platelets of 76,000. A lumbar puncture is consistent with bacterial meningitis. Which of the following is the most likely pathogen for this patient? A. Toxoplasma, B. Staph aureus, C. Pseudomonas, or D. H. flu. The correct answer is C. Pseudomonas. She's neutropenic, and she has signs and symptoms consistent with meningitis. This is confirmed with the studies such as the lumbar puncture, and she is most susceptible to gram-negative bacteria, including Pseudomonas. One important thing to realize is that Staph aureus would be more common in these neutropenic patients if she had a line infection, mucositis, or other evidence of skin cellulitides. In summary, fever in the neutropenic patient is common and can be the only sign of a severe underlying infection and can be a life-threatening medical problem. A thorough assessment of the patient with a good history and a physical exam are paramount. Lab work and cultures are important additional data to obtain, and immediate empiric antibiotic therapy is essential, particularly gram-negative coverage. Some of my key references include the 2010 update by the Infectious Disease Society of America, as well as two other papers important in treatment-induced neutropenia. Two main acknowledgments that I have for this talk are for Dr. Carlos De Castro, a hematology oncology professor at Duke University Medical Center, and Dr. Amy Zoss, who's also the program director of internal medicine and an infectious disease physician. They both were instrumental in this talk.